Here we go.
Okay, now you're host. Okay.
Perfect. Thank you so much. All right. So super. Let me make the screen big. All right. Wonderful. So we are delighted again to have Barbara Pasquini from the University of Pavia here to speak with us today. We had a really nice introduction to the physics of the inside, the guts of a proton and neutron last time. And now we're going to dive even deeper in, and I'm excited to hear what you have to say. Please take it away, Barbara, when you're ready.
Okay, thank you. So as usual, if you want to ask questions during the talk, please don't hesitate to do that. I cannot see you because I hidden the video panel, everything, then just interrupt me if you like. So then we start from the last slide I showed last time, where we have a summary of the kind of the distribution we have already encountered. One is the parton distribution function, where we have seen we can have one dimensional map, which give us the distribution of the proton is of the parton inside the proton as function of the longitudinal momentum fraction. On the other side, we have a different picture in the transverse coordinate space in terms of the Fourier transform of the form factor, where we can access the distribution in the transverse plane of the charge in the proton. So then one-dimensional map in momentum space, two-dimensional map in coordinate space. And now we can unify these two pictures in terms of generalized parton distribution function. And in this case, we have a three-dimensional picture in momentum space as a function of the longitudinal momentum fraction, and at the same time also in this coordinate space in the transverse plane. So what are the key information we can have from this distribution function? We can have three-dimensional plot, and this three-dimensional map give us the decomposition of the form factors as a function of x, the longitudinal momentum fraction. But what is even more important is that this generalized parton distribution give us a sum rule to access the angular momentum of the proton. In particular, what is the fraction of angular momentum of the proton carried by the different partons? And in addition, with the GPD, we have the unique possibility to access the form factors of the energy momentum tensor. They are called gravitational form factor, and we will see they will allow us to describe some mechanical properties of the nucleon. So the golden channel to access the GPD is from deeply virtual quantum scattering, where we have the scattering of an electron of the proton. And in one photon exchange approximation, we have the exchange of a virtual photon, which becomes a real photon in the final states. This transition from virtual to real photon means that we need a momentum transfer to the proton target. And we are looking at this process in the kinematics of a large virtuality of the photon, large center of mass energy, and small momentum transfers. In this kinematical condition, we can have a partonic description. We can factorize the process in terms of a hard scattering part, where we have the photon which coupled to one of the partons inside the proton. This is the Hendbach diagram, which is coupled with the non-perturbative part, which is parameterized in terms of generalized parton distribution function. Then one important property is the possibility to factorize in this way this process in a non-perturbative and hard part. And this factorization property is valid for the deeply virtual quantum scattering process, but also for a variety of processes which differ for the final state. We have always an initial virtual photon, but in the final state, we can detect virtual photon, a pion, a meson, a rho, or even more complex configuration of meson. And what is important is the second property, that is universality, which tells us that the same...
I'm sorry, Barbara.
Yeah.
Sorry, what's the difference between Q and T?
Q is the virtuality of, okay, is the virtuality of the photon, then is the difference between the momenta of the final and initial electron, and here is the difference between the momenta of the proton. If you write the momentum conservation, you have K of the electron plus P, which is equal to P prime, K prime, and Q prime of the photon. Then you see this, K prime minus K is not equal to P prime minus P. It is equal to P prime minus T when you have, for example, the real photon which is emitted by the electron. So if you have this leg which is touched here, then in this case, the difference between these two momenta is equal to different from to this one, otherwise no.
Super.
So,
when we do these measurements, how, so normally in deep inelastic scattering, we measure the final state electron, and that's really it. With these measurements, do we need a precise determination of the momentum of both the photon and the final state proton?
Yeah, this is an exclusive process, and you have to reconstruct the kinematics of these two final particles. So then you detect the photon, and then you can reconstruct from momentum conservation also the momentum of the final proton.
Oh, I see. Okay. And is that particularly challenging or easy for the experimentalists?
It's particularly challenging, but they can do that.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I mean, I will say something more about the experiment at the end. So there are measurements from JLab, Hermes, Zeus, and then Prospect to measure also this function or this kind of processes also at electron ion collider. So then you can have, now also with the upgrade of JLab, the measurements are also quite accurate also. So then...
So you're talking about proton in, proton out, right? I would imagine you might get excited states that have the same quantum numbers otherwise. That's probably a contamination to what you're talking about here, right?
Okay, so you can have all the, when you are at low energy here in this blob.
Oh, you want too much, okay.
Yeah, you have the virtual excitation of all the possible resonances for the proton.
Mm-hmm.
But this is a kind of, this is when you are at low energy, uh-huh. And this is the physics that you have in the case of the generalized polarizability, virtual quantum scattering at low energy, the process I was speaking about last time. Indeed, you are all the virtual excitation of the resonances. When you go at high energy, here is, you don't speak any longer in terms of resonances, but you can have all, you give this kind of partonic description. Here, I will show you some possible model. Here, for example, you can model the proton in terms of its parton configuration, three quarks plus gluon and so on. And then you are looking really to the partonic description. So then this process is very nice going from generalized polarizability to GPD, because really you see the transition from low energy to high energy, and also how you change your description. At low energy, you have a description in terms of resonances. Going at high energy, you are really proving the parton content of the proton. So, and this is exactly the same process we were speaking about last time, but last time we were considering at low energy in terms of generalized polarizabilities.
Thank you.
Great, thank you.
Yeah. Sorry, my voice is not really cooperating, so I might try to say something, you don't hear it.
So then the nice thing is that now you have a variety of exclusive processes where you can access the GPD, because the same function enter in all these processes where you change the final states that you are detecting. So then now we have objects which depend on three variables, because we have finite momentum transfers. We can decompose this momentum transfer in terms of longitudinal component, which is called Xi. And then we also have T, which is related also to the transverse component of the momentum transfer. Then in general, we have three functions. X bar now is the average fraction of the longitudinal momentum carried by the parton. Since you have a finite momentum transverse, when you take out from the initial state a parton, you have a momentum fraction, which is equal to X bar plus psi, which is different from the momentum fraction that you have for the parton, which is inserted back in the final proton. So in the case of PDF, you have the same X for the initial and final parton. Here, you have a longitudinal momentum transfer between the initial and final parton. So, and then this is the formal definition of the GPD. You have this operator, psi is a quark field. You have psi bar psi, a different point, and then you have a bilocal operator. You have gamma, which can be a Dirac gamma matrix. And when you look at the leading twist, the most important contribution in expansion in 1 over Q square, you can have this kind of structure. And you are taking the matrix element of this operator between a proton state, which have different momenta in the initial and final states. In the case of the parton distribution function, you have exactly the same operator, but you take P prime equal to P. Then in the case of parton distribution amplitude, you have forward matrix element. Here we have a non-forward matrix element. And I'm when sorry. You take, yeah.
I'm sorry, what is a lambda? Is that the spin?
This gamma.
No, the capital lambda that's associated with the P.
Ah, yes, lambda prime, lambda is the spin of the proton.
Okay, super, thank you.
So, and then you can choose a different polarization state for the initial and final proton. Then you can have unpolarized, longitudinal polarized, transverse polarized proton. At the same time, you can also change the polarization of the parton. Then here you do that by taking different gamma structure. So if you take gamma plus, here you have just a contribution of partons with the same helicity. Then you have unpolarized quarks. If you take gamma plus, gamma five, you project on the longitudinal polarization of the quark. And with this structure, you are looking at quark which are transverse polarized. So then take into account different polarization of the proton, different polarization of the quark, you can write this table, and then you see the different kind of GPD that are sensitive to the different polarization. So in particular, here in the diagonal, you have the GPD which survive when you take the forward limit, P prime equal to P. Then this GPD just reduce to the parton distribution function. In red, you have GPD, which do not have any limit in the forward limit. So they are zero in the, actually they are not zero in the forward limit, but they enter in the scattering amplitude through some kinematical coefficient, which vanish when you take the collinear kinematics. That means that these red GPD are not accessible in deep inelastic scattering. And this one, you also can see that in general for this GPD, you have, for example, in this case, you have unpolarized quark and transverse polarized nucleon. Then you have helicity flip at the level of the proton, but you don't have an helicity flip at the level of the quark. It means that you need some orbital angular momentum transfer to have access to this GPD. Orbital angular momentum transfer is associated with momentum transfer to the proton. Okay, this is a little bit technical, but this is just to say in collinear kinematics, you always just are looking to matrix element where you take diagonal contribution in the spin space. In the case of the GPD, you can also access more correlation in the spin space. You have you can study more correlation between orbital angular momentum of the parton, spin of the parton, and spin of the nucleon. you have a much more rich structure.
So the matrix element that you've written, it's the GPD, it gives me the impression that you can explicitly calculate this thing.
Huh.
Right? So can you
explicitly calculate what?
The GPD.
Yes. Yes.
And then if that's the case, what do I put into those proton states?
Exactly. I will just go through this one now. So
okay. Well, thank you.
So first we work out this operator, and we give a partonic interpretation for this operator, and then we try to see how we can model these states and then evaluate the matrix element. So to make this partonic interpretation, I introduce very shortly light from quantization, which is very convenient, the most convenient description you can use when you look at the deep inelastic scattering kinematics. So probably you know this paper by Dirac. So this is an old paper. It's very nice because in this paper I introduce different forms of relativistic dynamics, so which give different possibility to describe relativistic system, which are perfectly equivalent. It's something like you have when you quantum mechanics, when you use different description, you can have Heisenberg description, interaction description, or Schrodinger description. They are different description of the same the same dynamics, but depending on the kind of system you want to study, the kind of process you want to study, one can be more convenient than the other one. Here is the same in the case of a relativistic system. So we are used normally to work in ordinary time. So we introduce in the four-dimensional space x0 as our time variable. Then we have the usual space variable. And then the dynamics is described in terms of the Hamiltonian. Then when we quantize the system, we choose a hypersurface in this Minkowski space at fixed time, for example, t equal to 0. And then through the Hamiltonian, we study the evolution in time, the evolution in time in this direction of the system. Then through the Hamiltonian, we go to surface which are parallel to the initial one at t equal to 0. And this evolution in this direction depends on the dynamics of the system. So then if you look at the generators of the Poincaré group, you can distinguish six generators which are independent on interaction and four generators which depend on the interaction. So the generators which are independent on the interaction are also called kinematical because they correspond to transformation which leave the system in the same surface at fixed time. So then if I start in one point here, apply one kinematical operator, I make a transformation inside this plane. And since I do not change the time, I do not have anything which depends on the Hamiltonian then anything which depends on the dynamics of the system. In this description now, we use a different coordinates. We introduce a new time, which is given by this combination. And then we have the complementary combination of these two variables, here x0 plus x3, here x0 minus x3, and then the transverse coordinate. So they play the same role as the space coordinate in the instant form. And here now we have a new time. So then what we are doing, we quantize the system on a surface which is tangent to the light cone. So here we fix the initial condition of our system and we make evolution now with this operator, which is the analog of the Hamiltonian H in instant form. And this operator now describes evolution along this direction of time. And we evolve through surface which are parallel to the initial one, which is tangent to the light cone. Now the operator, the transformation which are independent interaction are seven. So this form of dynamics is the form which has the largest number of Poincaré generator which are interaction independent. So then you can, since you have now 7 operators which do not depend on the interaction, the description of the system can become much more easier. So in this, using this now light front dynamics, we can also introduce 2 operators. They are 2 projectors which project our field in what are called good and bad components. What are the good and bad components? So we can look at the Dirac equation. If we project the Dirac equation with this projector, so we see this, the bad component enter in this equation. Here is the equation of motion for the good components. Now in the equation of motion for the good components, you have something which depends on the time, the light from time plus component. So this is the true dynamical field. On the other side, the minus component does not contain in this equation nothing which depends on time. So then this is a constrained field which can be just related to the dynamical field Psi plus. This is why this is called the bad component. The dynamical field, the true degree of freedom of our system are just the good component. So now, so here I just give some detail. In the case you want to make the calculation, here you find the ingredients, because you can write down the Dirac spinor in terms of the new variable of light front variable. You can use the projector to project in the good component. And now with these ingredients, we can calculate explicitly the operator here, which enter in definition of the GPD. Particularly if you use now this description, light front description, we can find out that this operator correspond to have just this contribution in terms of the good component, psi bar psi. Now for the field, you can take the usual Fourier transform in terms of annihilation and creation operator of quark and antiquark. This is for psi. Similarly, for the psi bar, you will have a creation operator of quark and annihilation operation of antiquark. Then you take this Fourier transform, you write it here, you apply momentum conservation, and then now you have this kind of partonic description. You can distinguish 3 regions. In particular, in one region, you have this operator, B daga B, evaluated in terms of different plus component of the quark. So then here you, what you are doing in this region, you destroy from the initial proton a quark, a parton, with this longitudinal momentum fraction, and then you create it back in the final proton with a different momentum fraction. So then you have the same structure, BB daga, of the momentum density operator, but now you are taking the non-diagonal components of the momentum density matrix. So then we don't have B daga B with the same momentum. This corresponds to have the diagonal component which allow you to have a probabilistic interpretation, because if you evaluate with the same fraction of momentum, you are have the probability to take out a parton with X bar, for example, if you take psi equal to 0, and then to insert back with the same momentum. Then you count the number of parton with that momentum fraction in the proton. Now you are looking to the different momentum fraction. Then we lose the probabilistic interpretation, but we gain information on the quark momentum correlation. So you can also have a different region for this kinematics where you have a similar description, but now in terms of anti-quark. And here you take off the anti-quark from the initial proton and you insert back in the final proton with different momentum fraction. So in this, these 2 regions that's just different because you are taking different range for the momentum fraction X bar of the parton. Then you have another region, which is called Herbert, which is between myn oxide and xi. So in this case, you are taking out from the initial proton a pair of quark-antiquark. So then you take out from the initial proton and you don't create it in the final proton. Then here you have a mismatch in the number of parton between the initial and final proton. You can also work out with the spin of the parton. So if you take different structure for the gamma matrix, which enter in the definition of the GPD, you can also make different projection in the spin space. Then in particular, in the Lissity space, you have this combination, then you just sum over all the possible, overall the Lissity of the parton, then you have the unpolarized parton, or you can make projection in the transfer spin space, which involve a Lissity flip of the parton in the initial and final states. So then by making also this different projection in the spin space, you recover contribution from different kind of GPD. So which is just the table which I showed you before. So this table just corresponds to different gamma matrices, then different projection of the creation and annihilation operator of the parton in the spin space. And this corresponds to different GPD. So this is at the level of the operator, what are the parton interpretation. Now, as you were saying, we needed to build a model for the protostate. We want to calculate the matrix element. So we can do with this light conFOC expansion, which means that we take our proton and we make an expansion in terms of different parton configuration that you can find inside the proton. So this expansion is possible in the light from quantization because what is usually, you probably heard about that, usually we say that in light front, the vacuum is trivial. This is because we are taking down only state with P plus greater than zero. Then since this state is an eigen state of the plus momentum, P plus equal to zero for the vacuum means that the vacuum is formed by zero parton, by is empty, because you, since you take the constraint as the parton inside, the parton which could be inside the vacuum have a plus component equal to zero, the vacuum is eigen state of the vacuum of the pi plus operator and correspond to pi plus equal to zero, then the vacuum can be just build up with zero particle. Then in this case, you can really make this kind of FOC, you can build this FOC space in terms of different partonic configuration. So here the most simple is three quark, which carry the right quantum number to reproduce the quantum number of the proton, in particular to reproduce its momentum and to reproduce its helicity. Then you can go one step further, and then you can have in addition one gluon, or you can have three quark plus a pair of quark antiquark, and so on. You can build up more and more complex parton configuration. So these states are eigenstate of the momentum, at the same time also eigenstate of the light front helicity. So if we make this expansion in the FOC space, you see that in this expansion, each term is weighted by a coefficient which gives you the probability amplitude to find that particular parton configuration in the proton. And this probability amplitude is just what we call light front wave function. So for each parton configuration, you write a light front wave amplitude, which give you the probability amplitude to find that particular FOC state inside the proton. This light front wave function depends on the longitudinal momentum fraction of the parton and the transient momentum of the parton refer to, I mean, this is the intrinsic transient momentum, then refer to the zero transfer to the zero, let's call center of mass state. So then this is the transfer momentum referred to the proton when the proton is taken at rest with zero transfer component. So then these are just the internal variables. And this is a very nice property, because even if we boost the proton from zero transfer momentum to a finite transfer momentum, the light from the wave function do not change. So they are frame independent. Whatever is the frame where you write your proton states, the light from the function always depends on the intrinsic variables. And in addition, they are eigenstates of the light frontalicity of the part, eigenstate of the licity of the proton lambda. And also this is a nice property in this gauge, because the orbital angular momentum is a notion which is gauge dependent. Then everything, always when you work electron quantization, you choose this gauge. Then in this gauge, you have the light front wave function are also eigenstate of the orbital angular momentum. So then you can write down this angular momentum conservation. The spin of the proton is given by the sum of the light frontalicity of the partons plus the orbital angular momentum carried by the partons.
So when you do this expansion in terms of quark states, I'm to understand this these multi quark states are just created from the vacuum by creation operators and so forth.
Perfect. Yes, exactly. Yeah.
And
Thank you.
The claim is that and that's it. The proton is simply a superposition of all of these things that share the quantum given quantum numbers.
Yeah, in principle, I mean, you should make this is a expansion with a infinite contribution, because you can have all the most complex configuration you can think of. But what happens in general, okay, depends on the kinematics. You are more sensitive to one configuration or the other configuration. Normally, when we say we are, you go at high value of X, where we probe the valence contribution, the main contribution is coming from this state. At low X, at low momentum fraction, you become much more sensitive to the gluon, then this configuration is very important. So, but in general, in principle, you can have infinite parton configuration you can build up to reconstruct your proton. In a model calculation, in practice, you have to make a truncation.
Okay. This information, the dependence of these different weights on X and so forth, is this something that you can calculate from first principles, or
no? You have to make models.
Okay.
So this light from wave function, you have to make a model. You don't know. Or in principle, what you can do, you write down the Hamiltonian, which describe your three quark system, but you have to make a model, and then you solve the Schrödinger equation for this state. So this is a possibility. There are models, so you have to assume a model for your Hamiltonian, and then you solve the Schrödinger equation for three quarks, for these states, and so on. But in any case, this is very much model dependent. Normally, you do that when you are studying the spectroscopy of the proton, when you are looking at the resonance states of the proton. So otherwise, what you can do, and this is what I did, you write a model, some ansatz for your light from the function, you assume some parametrization. You can you fit the parameters of your model, for example, to the form factors. And then with these fit parameters, you make prediction for other distribution function. So what is my dream? Which is, I don't know if it will become, it will never become possible, is to make a parameterization which includes, let's say, I just did it recently for the pion. For the pion, I built up a parametrization for the first state, which is QQ bar, then QQ bar and an additional QQ bar, QQ bar gluon and QQ bar to gluon. So you can make some educated guess for the parametrization because these light from the function are related to some other objects which are the distribution amplitude. Then somehow I can make some educated answers for the longitudinal dependence. Then I make a model for the transfer momentum dependence and I make a fit to the fourth factor, which is sensitive to the transverse momentum and to the Parton distribution function, which is more sensitive to the longitudinal momentum fraction. So I can make a combined fit with these two to fit simultaneously the longitudinal part and the transverse momentum part. Then in principle, I can use the GPD and to fit everything simultaneously. I didn't use GPD because we don't have data for the GPD of the pion. So what I want to say, probably I will come back to this right now. All these objects can be written down in terms of overlap of the light from the function in different kinematics. Then if you, for the four factors, you have a similar formula, but still you have an overlap in different range of K of the momentum. So then you can use this description in terms of light from the function to build up all these different distribution function. They all probe different region in the momentum space of the light from wave function. And then you can combine the information which come from PDF, GPD, form factor, to try to reconstruct your wave function. So to do that, you need data for PDF, we have a lot for proton. You need data for form factor, we have a lot, and also data for GPD. And the dream will be to make a combined fit of all these functions. So this is for GPD is much more difficult to use this description to make a fit. But my dream will be to combine all the data you have from all these different kind of distribution function to make a simultaneous fit, which allow you at the end to reconstruct your light from the function. So then, so just to see how we can have this kind of description. So with what we did now, we model our protostem in terms of light from the function, we evaluate the matrix element, and then we find this kind of integrals. And in particular, depending on the region, you also probe different Fock state components of the oral light front wave function. Because in the Diglap region, we have seen this, you take out a parton and you set it back in the final states. Then you are looking at the same parton configuration in the initial and final states. You destroy a parton and you create it back. But in the ERB region, you also probe the overlap of wave function which have different parton configuration. Because in this case, you destroy the quark anti-quark pair in the initial states and you don't create this pair in the final states. Then you are also non-diagonal in the Fock space. So then you can imagine it also is the most difficult region to model, to calculate in models. But I think that this description in light from quantization is very intuitive because really can tell you which kind of information you can have on your wave function. And also it helps you to have this simple partonic description of the GPD.
Okay, so if I'm to understand this, you truncate your Fock space expansion. And then you have to create a model for each of those coefficients.
Okay. Yes, exactly. In principle, the sum goes from 3 to infinity, but in model calculation, you are forced to truncate. And now, so for the GPD, I have some results up to the 5 parton components. because it's very difficult. You can imagine when you go higher with a number of partons, also the calculation become much, much more difficult. Yeah.
So what am I learning though if I'm doing all of this model like term by term?
I learned the wave function of the proton.
Okay.
I mean, principally, the wave function of the proton, you know everything in principle. So I mean, I learn, but since I make a truncation, you are right that I can learn the dynamics for some Fock state, some parton configuration in the proton.
So,
but I'm learning because, I mean, how is done the wave function depends on the dynamics of the parton inside the proton. Then I learn about the dynamics of the parton inside the proton. I learn the wave function contains all the information about some particular Fock states, about the dynamics of some particular Fock states inside the proton.
So this expansion is in some way related to the twist expansion?
No.
Not at all. So
expansion comes into play when I choose here. Sorry. When I choose here the gamma matrix.
Uh-huh.
So leading twist just okay. Here to the fact that I have gamma matrix.
Okay.
And the fact that I have only plus component, the good component for the field is just because I am at leading twist.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then when I go at a higher twist, I have also contribution from the bad component with minus.
Yep.
And then here it really becomes much more complicated also for the model calculation. Because in model calculation, when you create partons, you are creating the good components of the field.
Uh-huh.
So the parton that you created, they refer to the good components.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
So these wave functions, right? How are they related to PDFs? And maybe
GPDs. Right? I mean, you have access to the whole.
Yeah, well, yeah, but my question then is, for PDFs, you can see that for certain kinematics, you can see, I guess, the gluon distribution rising, right? As you go to smaller and smaller heads, okay? Can I get this information still from these wave functions? Because to me, it seems like you stop them at a fixed number of patterns, right?
Yes.
So given this, can I say anything from the wave functions about seeing like that I have increasing numbers of gluons as I fix my Q and I raise and I decrease X?
Yeah. Okay. So you can still, when you increase the number of partons, normally the contribution from the higher Fock state, I mean, this series is converging in terms of contribution. This is the hope. So, for example, in the model which I just did for the pion, we also included gluon. Okay, the data we have for the PDF, the gluon contribution to the PDF of the pion are not very accurate, then the error bar are very big. But we can really see the behavior, the rise of the gluon contribution as small x. So you can capture the main feature of the parton distribution already from the first contribution in the Fock space expansion, because this series is converging quite fast. Already, if you go at higher x where you have the valence part, you can already obtain reasonable results for this distribution, just taking into account this parton configuration, the three quark.
So for small x, then you say you see this this first contribution go down quickly, right?
Yes. Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
All
right. Okay. I have to say, okay, depending on the community, so if you, I mean, the high energy physics community is used to have data which are very, very accurate, and they are really precision physics. Now, for this kind of GPD, and for example, in TMD, we are already happy when a model is able to give a good description within 30%. I mean, the error bar is still quite big. Then also with this model, it's not a precision calculation. It's just we are in the non-perturbative regime, and already a model which gives prediction which are with an accuracy of 20% is already a good model. So
I'm perfectly happy with that. But I'm just stuck at the same point that Mwanda was stuck, I think, is in the Foxbase description, you have one gluon in there.
Yeah.
So how do you think about the rise of the number of gluons in this picture? How do you square this in your head?
I don't have very much experience for the proton because I don't have a model in this scheme for the, there are no model actually in this scheme in terms of also taking into account the gluon contribution. There are other model like Dalkor model, which I mean are very, I don't like very much this Dalkor model. You can reproduce the feature, I mean, the feature of this low X behavior. You cannot really say, I mean, the precise detail, you cannot use it to make a precise prediction, this is for sure. You can see the main feature, I would say, but always within 20-30% percent of accuracy of the model, if it's a good model already. Yeah. But in this kind of description, I have to say, for the proton, there are no explicit, let me see. No, there is something recently, but they also did, there is something for the pion, but not for the neutron. So also in the model we did, where for the first time, we include a contribution from the C, QQ bar, and from the gluon at the same time. I think this is the first model in light from quantization. There are other models which have only the gluon contribution, but not the C. Mm-hmm. So also when you, because normally, okay, this is also important. You make this model at a certain scale. So which is typically a scale of 1 GV squared. And you want to compare with data which are at much higher Q squared.
Mm-hmm.
Then you have to use evolution.
Okay. So it comes from evolution, otherwise.
And when you want to use evolution, so if you include the gluon, necessarily, I think you have to include the C.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. So then now, just last week, we had this model for the pion where we had both. Otherwise, there are other models where that up to now, this is the BLFQ collaboration, which is LF is for light front. B, I do not remember. This is light front quantization. Okay. So they had only the gluon, but I know they're also working to include the quark QQ bar component. But just for the pion, for the gluon, I'm not aware of model calculation with the gluon up to now.
Mm-hmm.
I have a student who did it in the PhD thesis, but we didn't publish anything because we are not so happy about the results, but we didn't go into much detail. So, okay, so. Okay, it's very good that we have a discussion. I'm just looking at the time because I will never finish the slides I have, but okay. At a certain point, we will stop and at the point we are. So then, this is already some property of GPD, which I already anticipated. Forward limit, that means that you don't have momentum transfer, then Xi, the fraction of longitudinal momentum fraction is equal to zero, and T is equal to zero. And then there are only 3 GPD which survive, and they reduce to what you have in the collinear case in terms of parton distribution function. Unpolarized parton distribution function elicit distribution function, longitudinal polarized core distribution, and transversity. So this is for quark, but you have analogous relation also for gluons, except that for gluon, you do not have the transversity. So the other GPD can be different from zero, but they do not appear in inclusive kinematics. So then here from GPD, you have new information. And here I didn't write it explicitly, but all this function depends on the renormalization scale. And then if you have a model at a certain scale, low scale, you have to apply evolution. And you have different evolution equation depending on the region where you are. So in the Diglap region, you use the Dock, Schixer, Gribov, Lipatov, Altarelli, Parisis evolution equation. This is also why also you use this name for x larger than xi and x smaller than minus xi. And in the intermediate region, you use the Efremov, Raduskin, Belitsky, Lipatov equation, evolution equation, which gives you also the name to the region, Elbert region. So on the other side, if you integrate over x, you see already that from the definition of the GPD, integrating over x, your quark operator becomes a local operator and becomes exactly the local operator which enters in definition of the form factor. So then integrating over x, the GPD gives you back the electromagnetic form factor, in this case F1 and F2. Then in the longitudinal polarized case, you reduce to the electrovic form factor, the axion form factor, the pseudoscalar form factor. So then you obtain objects which are the form factor, then the renormalization scale independent. And also what is nice, you see this here, you are integrating over x, then you eliminate the dependence on this variable. Then you have a t-dependent function, but the xi dependence disappeared. So this is a nice property and also a very important constraint for model calculation. Then integrating over x bar, the GPD, you get objects which are independent of xi. And this is just a consequence of Lorentz invariance. And also something which comes from a property which I will tell you about later, which is the polynomiality of GPD, which is a very important constraint for model calculation. Okay, so then we can construct three-dimensional map for in the case of the GPD, and we can proceed in a very analogous way we have seen in the case of the form factor. In the case of the form factor, you have this operator, so matrix element of this operator. And the forward matrix element of this operator give you the charge. In the non-forward case, they give you the form factor, depending on the momentum transfer. And by Fourier transform, you obtain the distribution in the coordinate space. Now we can have something similar in the case of GPD. Now you have a bilocal quark operator, which defines the GPD, when you take non-forward matrix element. In the forward case, this operator, the matrix element, this operator is related to the pattern distribution function. Then the natural question is, if we can construct a Fourier transform of the GPD, and then to obtain something which gives out the distribution of the pattern with a given momentum fraction. Very similar to what we have done for the form factor. This case, we constructed from the Fourier transform the distribution of the charge of the proton . Here, we take the Fourier transform of the GPD. Then we have still the distribution in the transfer space, but now we also as a function of the momentum fraction carried by the proton. This nice description was first introduced by Matthias Burkhardt in 2003. It was really something very important, because this is a very nice picture you can obtain from the GPD. And to understand this picture, what we do, we take a proton which is localized in the transverse momentum space. So we can construct now something which is very similar to the center of mass that we have in the case of non-relativistic system when you use the Galilei transformation. So in a non-relativistic system, you construct the center of mass of the system. Now, similarly, for this relativistic system, you can construct something similar, which is the center of plasma momentum. So instead of weighting the transverse position of the parton with the mass, you weight with the plus component of the momentum of the partons. So this analogy can be made because you can find a subgroup of a light front operator which are isomorph to the Galilei group. So then the property that you have in the case of a Galilei transformation can be translated also in the case of this subgroup of light front operator. The subgroup of light front operator are the transverse boost. So these boosts are just kinematical. They do not depend on the interaction. Then you see in the analogy, instead of the mass, you take the plus component for the momentum. And then instead of having this transformation for the three momentum, now you made the same transformation with P plus in terms of M for the transfer component of the momentum. So then this, you can localize now your state in terms of this transverse position. And then also you can identify what is the transverse position of your active parton relative to this, to the position of the center of the proton. And then with this localized object, which is taken now is again state of P plus, and then this new operator, RPERP, you also can take this combination of the light front helicity. Then you are taking a proton which is polarized in the X direction. And then you can define something which are GPD in this space, in the impact parameter space, which means the space where you take P plus and the transverse component of the position of the position. So you take matrix element now in for this localized object in terms of RPERP, eigenstate of RPERP. And now your operator also depends on the impact parameters of the parton. So in particular now, you are taking matrix element where we do not have longitudinal momentum transfers. P plus is the same the initial and final states. So in this case now, you can really give to this object a probabilistic interpretation. So what you are looking with this object is the probability to have a parton with this momentum fraction and a disposition in the transverse plane. And also more nice, this object can be just obtained by Fourier transform of the GPD. So this is very nice. And all this kind of interpretation was given by Burkhardt, who has a series of very nice paper where in a very clear way he explained this kind of interpretation. So we can reconstruct now this impact parameter distribution from data. So to do that, we have to measure GPD as a function of x and t at xi equal to zero. So actually xi equal to zero is a kinematical point that you cannot access from experiment. You can measure at a final xi, and then what you have to do is an extrapolation at xi equal to zero. Then if you have enough data as a function of t, ideally, you should go to t equal to infinity, which is not possible. Then you also here, you have to make some model assumption to extrapolate at very large t. And then you make the Fourier transform, and then you construct your IMPA parameter GPD. So I think there is no way to construct IMPA parameter GPD which are completely model independent. First, because of this reason, and first, because you have to make a Fourier transform, then you have to make an integral up to infinity, which it cannot be accessed by through data. So then from this Fourier transform with some ansatz to reconstruct this integral, you can access the GPD in the IMPA parameter space. This has been done. So then normally, when you have flat dependency in T, this is translated in the IMPA parameter states in neuro distribution in BPERP. Vice versa, steep distribution as a function of T means that in general you have wide distribution in BPERP. And then from this data by Kidal, Van der Hagen, and Dupré, so they reconstructed this picture, which gives you as a function of X this squared radius of the distribution of the quark in the impact parameter space. And they reconstructed this kind of picture. So then you have this kind of hat as a function of X, X going from 0 to 1. Then going from 0 to 1, you have a distribution which becomes more and more narrow, which means that when X is going to 1, the active parton carries all the momentum of the proton, and at the end, it is just identified with the center of momentum. So since it carries all the momentum of the proton in the impact parameter space, just coincide with the center of momentum, which is the center of the proton. And this is why it is given in this shape of a hat. It's shrinking where you go at X going to 1. This is actually something which is completely, this statement is completely model independent, it's just kinematics. X going to 1 just means that all the fraction of the momentum of the proton is carried by one parton. So there isn't, it's just kinematics. This is a nice picture, but actually this is...
this is definitely not Gaussian, right?
Yeah. And this is not reconstructed from data, because indeed what the data you have allow you to reconstruct just a very, very small portion of this hat. So the hope that with new data, in particular, there are very nice new data from JLab 12, is to try to enlarge the domain in X where you have, you can really reconstruct from data your hat, and hopefully to go even, so hopefully you can reconstruct a little bit, but you will go in a larger and larger X. So that what I wanted to point it out, that from data, you really can just now reconstruct a very small portion of this feature. So this there are some model dependence. So what do we do now? Now we will have a new chapter about the relation between the energy momentum tensor and the matrix element of the energy momentum tensor and the form factor that you can access from GPD. I think we don't have time to go on. What do you think? I think it's already quite late.
Are we happy to keep going? I mean, I think we might be happy to learn as much from you as you're willing to teach us.
Okay, probably I can just tell very shortly about this gravitational form factor, and then I will stop. I will try to be as fast as possible. So then we know very, very well what is the energy momentum tensor and all the kind of information that they can give us for a continuum system. So now we want to extend this picture, to apply the same picture to the proton. So by taking the matrix element of the energy momentum tensor of quark and gluon between proton states. And then from this matrix element, we can have information about spin of the proton, mechanical properties of the proton, pressure, shear forces inside the proton, and also something about the region of the proton mass. So particular when you take the matrix element of the energy momentum tensor, you can write down this parametrization in terms of form factor. So these are form factor with quark and gluon contribution, which are called the gravitational form factor. This is just a general parametrization. So like you take the current, the electromagnetic current, you calculate the non-formal matrix element, you make a decomposition in terms of electromagnetic form factor. Here is the same for this new current, the current of the gravitational force which couples now with the proton. So you are probing the you are looking at the gravitational interaction of the proton, which is, we don't have hope to access it from experiment, it's very weak, but the GPD allows you to obtain information on this gravitational force factor. This is also why the GPD are so nice. So they give access now to this gravitational force factor that otherwise you cannot have any hope to access from experiment. So in particular, you take moments of the GPD, moments in X, and then these moments of X are related to different combinations of the gravitational force factor. So what is the meaning of this force factor? So at T equal to zero, this form factor just give you the fraction of momentum carried by the parton. So this is, let's say, the charge of this form factor, which is the momentum fraction carried by the parton. T equal to zero, this form factor is just the angular momentum carried by the parton. And this is a new structure constant, which is called the D term. This term is associated to the stability of the nucleon because it gives us information about the pressure and the shear forces inside the proton. If you take the Fourier transform from the momentum space to the coordinate space, you can write now the distribution of shear forces now evaluated inside the proton. And in particular, the pressure is related to the D-term. So there were this D-term form factor from reconstructed from data, from analysis of GPD data. And these are this line in yellow. So these are lattice calculation. And here are some model calculation. So you see here is very nice the spatial relation calculation because so last time we saw the spatial relation for the generalized polarizability. We use the same formulas, the spatial relation calculation also to calculate this D form factor. So and actually it gives a very nice description compared with the data. But anyhow, so what it was done from this data was constructed the Fourier transform to obtain now this distribution of the pressure as a function of R. R is the distance from the center of the proton. So this is just for the quark contribution. So then the gluon contribution was completely neglected. And then you see this, this green band was is what you obtain with this large error bar from this data for the D form factor. Then with including the 12 GVJ lab data, you expect to shrink to narrow the error band. This is the expected results. But in any case, what is interesting, the kind of shape you obtain. You have near the core of the proton, you have a positive contribution from the quark, which corresponds to the repulsive pressure, which would tend to expand your proton. But this is balanced from this negative contribution, which enter into play at a larger value of R, which is the confining pressure. And this positive and negative contribution nicely compensate in such a way that if you calculate this integral, you obtain zero. So perfect compensation, which means that you have a stable object where the passive and confining pressure just balance. So these results were published in a Nature paper, but there are many approximations in extracting this pressure. So then there was another Nature paper by Kumerichki who tried to outline what are the approximations of this calculation, and then in particular using the same data, but using neural network analysis, he obtained now this red value, which is actually very much consistent with zero. This is what the results you obtain for the D term, the four factor at equal to zero. So this is what you obtain from the experimental analysis I showed you before. This is the new analysis by Kumerichki. And in between, there was also other analysis, including more data and a global fit from available DVCS data with neural network. And then you find that it's something which actually you cannot say what it is, this term is something which also you cannot definitely judge about the sign of this term. Particular, the sign of this term is particularly interesting because in all the model calculation, you find this, this one should have as a negative sign, is negative. And this one was considered something like an indication that for a stable object like the proton, you should expect that this D term gives you a negative contribution. So I think, we can stop here. The next topic would have been to discuss the spin of the proton. Probably this one is something more known because, I think now it's a little bit too much. But what I will do, I will leave you the slides. So there are some slides about the way you can access from experiment. I will give you the slides. You can just go through them. In particular, there are references. And if you like, you can reach me by email, whenever you like to ask questions.
In particular, for the students, it is absolutely not clear where the spin comes from, really. That's a very old standing problem. It's a really weird thing because you have gauge fields in the game, and that actually makes it hard to define this properly. But so, just to let you know that this is still an issue, conceptually.
Yeah.
Thank you.
That was really fantastic. Thank you so much, covering a lot of ground. There were a lot of good questions. Are there any last questions before we let Barbara go? No, I think you were worn out and Moana, yes, please go ahead.
Yeah, so I'm just trying to find out what the inputs are into this calculating this D term, right? Because it looks like from the pressure diagram you have the plot, it looks like you could say something about the proton radius. Okay, that's where the pressure maybe goes to zero. Would that be right? Or can you use this to predict the size of the proton?
I think that you can better use the other one. The other picture to get something about the size of the proton. I will share the screen again. Okay. So you can get something about the size from this picture, actually, sorry. From this picture. Because here, really, you can calculate as a function. Okay, this is a function of x, but you can even integrate over x. And then what you get is the transverse size of the distribution of the parton in the proton. So then you look at the transverse plane and you see you have now something like a radius in two dimensions. Last time we had the radius from the form factor in three dimensions. Now it's in two dimensions. They can be related. Actually, let me see if I, okay. I think I have that slide, but it's just skipped. Let me see, no. Ah, okay, probably it's in backup because they are related. Exactly. So last time we look at the radius of the proton defined in terms of this form factor, so the electric form factor. And then we look at the three-dimensional Fourier transform. So, but this is, I mean, in a non-relativistic picture, so then normally one says, so I will not give detail, but you have some important relativistic correction. Then if you integrate over one dimension, you can get the two-dimensional radius, but this two-dimensional radius is not directly related to the radius which I introduce you, because what introduce you is something which is correct from the relativistic point of view. And then, but it's related to the two-dimensional non-relativistic radius by this relation. So I know there is a little bit confusion when we are speaking about too many radius, because, and also there are different communities who are speaking about radius. There are the community at low energy speaking about this radius in three dimension. Then at higher energy, we are speaking about this radius. They have slightly different interpretation, but they can be related. So then, this radius is what I show you that you can reconstruct from the Fourier transform of the one GPD. The D term is actually something different because it's really something which is related to different kind of, here you can, you see, you probe somehow the distribution of charge in the proton. On the other side, you really probe the distribution of the internal pressure force inside the proton. So and then this picture can tell you, for example, normally you say that when you have a negative tail contribution, is attributed to the pion cloud. You can have a picture like this one. You have a core of quark which repels each other, and then you have this repulsive picture, and then in the periphery you have something which binds the nucleon, something like pion cloud, which binds the nucleon, makes this effect of confining pressure. So this is normally the picture that you give.
So in your educated opinion, how are they related, the two radii? I guess the charge distribution, the radius, and here, like where the confining pressure just goes away. So I imagine it goes away when you go outside somehow, the proton, right?
So I think that you cannot. Because here you are probing in different radius, the distribution of different things. So here the distribution of some gravitational forces, the pressure, in the other case, the distribution of electromagnetic forces. So then are different distribution, different radii. So then you cannot, and this D term has not a relation with what we saw in and also this term, actually, if you want to write in terms of GPD, it has contribution from Erbler region, different kind of physics of what you have in the case of the other electromagnetic radius, which comes from the Dirac region. So also the partons which are active in these two terms, these pressure forces and the charge distribution are different. They are different interaction which come into play. So because here is Erbler region you have you are really sensitive to the this quark anti-quark pair inside the proton. On the other side, you are really sensitive to the single quark distribution. So different picture, really.
Okay.
Different here in different distribution. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you for that answer. Then I have one question, which is maybe more about the light cone quantization formalism or the relativistic dynamics. Why do we care so much about separating out this dynamic, you know, versus a kinematic variables there?
Very good question.
What's that important for?
Because normally, so for example, we are calculating here matrix element where the proton have a different momentum. So it means that to go from this proton to this proton, so to relate the momenta of these two protons, I have to make a transformation. So I have to make a boost from P to P prime. If the boost depends on the dynamics, I have to know what is the dynamics of this object to calculate the boost. If it only depends on the kinematics, I can calculate very easily. So if this boost depends on the dynamics, I have to know exactly what is the Hamiltonian which regulates the dynamics of this system. If it is just kinematics, much more simple.
Yeah.
Then all this interpretation of the GPD, we always take of this distribution in the impact parameter space at xi equal to zero, because at xi equal to zero, the longitudinal momentum transfer is equal to zero, then you have only transverse boost, a boost for the transfer component of the momentum, and this boost is kinematics, it's just kinematical. So and then you can have really all this nice interpretation. Otherwise, if you have something which depends on the interaction, you are in trouble. Also, when you have to calculate, so then if you have object where you have the same, just a transverse boost, it's like you are really calculating something like expectation value of the operator, because you are looking at the proton, the initial and final states with the same dynamics, then you really, if you calculate the matrix element of an operator of a quantity between these two states, which are related by kinematical transformation, you really can calculate something like an expectation value of that operator, because the dynamics of the initial and final states is the same. Then you can have, you can really have a much more nice interpretation of many quantity.
Okay, good. Thank you very much.
Okay, super. Thank you, Monde. Thank you, Barbara. Any last questions before we wrap up? Okay, super. Well, thank you very much.
Okay.
That was really, really great.
Okay.